Well, we're finally doing it because you asked for it in the comment section of every AIO video. So here it is. We're finally giving the Arctic Cooling Liquid Freezer AIOs the Robitech review treatment. Go ahead, clap, cheer, pat yourselves on the back. The winner is you. Now that you've had your moment, just know that in this review, we're gonna be honest and fair as we look at the data, as well as our experiences with a couple of liquid freezer AIOs. Oh, we'll have an opinion, or maybe seven, to share along the way. So strap yourselves in, keep your arms and legs inside the ride. It's about to get a little bumpy. And it all happens right here, right now, on Robitech. It would be an understatement to say that the Arctic Cooling Liquid Freezer AIOs have a bit of a cult following. Now, I'm not talking about the type of cult following that CrossFit and the McRib have. I'm talking about the frothing, twi-hard meat Swifty type of cult following, which honestly makes me a little scared about this video. But the whole Robitech team has put on their matching +7 to bravery pantaloons today, and we're gonna talk to you about the Liquid Freezer latest iteration, the Liquid Freezer 3. And because you are so awesome and you've waited so patiently for this review, we're gonna be looking at both the Liquid Freezer 3 Black and Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB, and as an added bonus, we're gonna be throwing in some comments about the 420mm versions as well. What can I say? We're kind of givers. Now, if you've had your eyes on the Arctic Cooling AIOs in the past, you may have noticed something different with these new versions. They've had a glow up since the previous generation. The change is amazing because, well, how do I say this nicely? Let's just say that the Arctic Liquid Freezer 2 has a nice personality, but we weren't making any plans to bring it home for the holidays, if you know what I mean. Aside from the way more appealing aesthetic, which I know is opinion-based, the Liquid Freezer 3 has a number of updated features, which we're gonna unpack throughout this review. Let's start with the pricing and where these AIOs land in comparison to other AIOs like them. At the time of recording this video, the Liquid Freezer 3 Black retailed for $129.99 and the Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB for $149.99. Now, the prices have been all over the place since we started our research for this video. So far as what we can tell, these are the non-sale prices. It is possible that you could find them for less, and many people have. When we look across the 360mm AIO landscape, Arctic Cooling Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs have some very stiff competition within that $100 to $200 price range, including Lian Li's Galahad Trinity 2 at $119.99 and the Fantex Glacier 1 D30 for $199.99. There are even a number of past favorites like the Deepcool LS720 and LT720 for $130.99 within striking distance of the Liquid Freezer 3. In fact, today when we're recording this video, we saw some Deepcool AIOs as cheap as $99.99 for their brand new 360mm AIOs. With that in mind, Arctic's prices are reasonable, but they don't stand out as more or less valuable at the price point like they used to. As for supported sockets, the Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs have a more limited range of compatibility compared to their competition. On the AMD side, the Liquid Freezer 3 supports Ryzen CPUs on both AM4 and AM5 sockets, which is pretty standard for most modern AIOs, but there is something that isn't quite standard about how the Liquid Freezer 3 mounts. Now, while the Liquid Freezer 3 has a large cold plate to accommodate lengthier CPUs, it doesn't quite hit dead center on AMD chips, which seems weird and almost wrong. But Arctic Cooling assures us that this is intentional as it allows the center of the cold plate to land right in the new Ryzen 7000 series hotspot. We'll have to see if that makes a noticeable difference, but still kind of weird to have part of your CPU not be covered. On the Intel side of things, compatibility for the Liquid Freezer 3 is limited to LGA 1700 sockets. While this sounds bad, remember, LGA 1700 covers 12th, 13th, and 14th gen Intel Core processors. While this decision does cut off anything older than 12th gen on the Intel side, sometimes you just have to let go of the past and move on. And Arctic Freezer said, sure, that's what we're gonna do. Now, the reason for this limitation is that Arctic Cooling opted to use a custom contact frame instead of providing traditional mounting hardware for Intel CPUs. This contact frame was designed to take some pressure from the normal CPU cooler tension mounting off of the PCB and to improve the CPU's contact with the cold plate. Once the contact frame is in place, the Intel mounting hardware uses two screws to attach it to the frame. Did they make us want to say some words that aren't brand safe? Yes. Did we say them? You know what? The world may never know. On top of all that, Arctic Cooling warns users that they may have some issues installing Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs if the topmost M.2 slot has a taller heatsink. If you're curious if your motherboard would have any issues, Arctic Cooling has a whole list on their website. They also offer to replace the heatsink if you ask them nicely. Now, when you put all of this together, the offset, basically for AMD, the contact plate for Intel, the heatsink sizing issues, all of this makes installation a bit awkward and in some cases borderline painful. I'm not even joking here. If you watch our stream from March 26, 2024, the Intel installation gave us some fits. And no, you won't hear me mutter any of those words I mentioned earlier. Also, because there are only two mounting screws on the pump head on either platform, the thing can be a bugger to get tightened down evenly. It's also worth noting that the radiators for the Liquid Freezer 3 AIO are chunky, which can be a very good thing. At 38 millimeters thick, they have an extra 11 millimeters of thickness. Now, while this extra girth can be beneficial for cooling, it also means that you're gonna have to need to think about things like where cables and fan headers or EPS are gonna be plugged in, and if there's even gonna be a fitment issue given certain cases. Now, I will say this. The Arctic Liquid Freezer 3 does have a few quality of life features out of the box. For instance, like the fans come pre-installed, which is awesome. The cables were managed pretty well, and the pump head detaches itself to give the user a bit more space to work with the mounting hardware. These are small things, but when you're fighting against other inconveniences, every bit of extra consideration is absolutely appreciated. Now, since we already touched on the topic of the radiator, let's move on to talk about the pump and fans. The Arctic Liquid Freezer 3 uses an in-house design pump with extra layers of user control. With an included cable, users can control the pump, radiator fans, and the special VRM fans separately. Arctic does give users the option of using a single connector for a more simplified approach if you're not interested in that much of control, but I will be honest, we've tested with the single one. I would definitely recommend using the 3-1. The pump itself has an operating range from 800 RPMs to 2800 RPMs, while the VRM fan has a range from 400 RPMs to 2500 RPMs. And in case you haven't catched this, you did hear that right. The Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs have a tiny fan for your motherboard power section, which is very cool and one of the biggest selling points of this AIO. And it is a very neat touch. What would also be neat is if you could go ahead and, you know what, slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring the notification bell so that you don't miss videos like this where we post, you know, the latest and greatest in hardware. We post reviews, helpful guides, and more here on the channel, and we'd love to have you join us on this crazy journey of PC building, neat tech, and of course, dad jokes. Okay, back to the review. Now, as for fans, we have a couple of different sets to talk about. Both the Liquid Freezer 3 Black and ARGB fans have that feature fluid dynamic bearings and PWM control. But that's where the similarities kind of end. The Black fans have an operating range of 200 to 1800 RPM and the maximum airflow of 56.30 CFM. While the ARGB fans have a range of 200 to 2000 RPMs, a maximum airflow rate of 48.82 CFM, and as the name suggests, they have addressable RGB, which means they cool so much better. Every light is a degree down. That's not true. Please don't send that to Steve. Now, just a little teaser here. The 420 millimeter version of the Liquid Freezer 3 Black comes with 340 millimeter fans that have an operating range of 200 to 1700 RPM. These puppies produce 72.8 CFM, which is a nice amount of airflow. We'll have to see if they can deliver cooler temperatures or actual puppies. Now that we know about the pumps and the fans, it's time to see how these AIOs compete in our thermal benchmarks, which is exactly what we're gonna talk about next. Now for our Intel, we did a 14700K, and for our Ryzen, we did a 7700X. Now understand, I just wanna set that up and you're gonna see all that stuff in the charts when we push it. The other thing too worth noting is that if you ever wanna see the raw data, check down in the comments below. We have links to that so you can absolutely see all the data for yourself and so it doesn't feel like we're hiding anything. Now at CPU idle, the Liquid Freezer 3 Black sat at an average CPU temperature of 27 degrees Celsius, with the ARGB equipped one was a degree warmer at 28 degrees. We look at the 420 millimeter non-ARGB version, it averaged 27 as well. These are really good idle temps. Now in our charts, this 27 to 28 degrees puts the Arctic Liquid Freezer in second and third place in between the reigning king, the Asus ROG Ryugen 3, which is much more expensive, and 26 degrees, and the Corsair IQ Link H150i at 29 degrees. Not a bad first showing, but under CPU load, this story kind of shifts. In our Cinebench tests, the Liquid Freezer 3 Black averaged temperatures of 72 degrees Celsius, while its ARGB counterpart averaged 73. As for the 420 millimeter version, it averaged 75 degrees Celsius. While the 360 millimeter version did push past the Fantex Glacier 1 D30, they were still among our warmer 360 millimeter AIOs in the test, with the 420 millimeter Liquid Freezer 3 looking more like a liquid thaw. Now during our gaming test, we saw a bit of a different story. The Liquid Freezer 3 Black averaged 45 degrees Celsius, which put it on par with Li & Li's Galahad 2 LCD. As for the Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB, if correlation equaled causation, we'd have to say that RGB improved gaming performance because this one placed second in our chart with an average CPU temperature of 44 degrees Celsius. As for our 420 millimeter AIO, it was solidly middling at 46, not bad, but not necessarily outstanding. Now you might look at these numbers and say, You're like yelling at the screen, Roby, we know that it's not great on Intel, but I heard that it's better on AMD. Oh, don't worry. We heard you before you even spoke, which, now that I say that out loud, sounds really creepy. Okay, so here's what we did. We did a comparable system. In fact, now we always do this. We have a similar system with a Ryzen 7 7700X in which we test both our sets of our AIOs using both Intel and AMD to give you a comparison. At idle, the Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB averaged 37 degrees Celsius on our AMD test bench, while the Liquid Freezer 3 Black averaged 39 degrees. These temps position both AIOs in context with the Deepcool Mystique at 38 degrees and the Corsair H150i at 36. As for the 420 millimeter version, it averaged around 37. Under load, we saw 86 degrees from both ARGB and the non-ARGB models, while the 420 millimeter version averaged slightly lower at 85. As for gaming, the Liquid Freezer 3 ARGB had our second coolest temperatures on the Ryzen side at 51 degrees Celsius, but the black version averaged 54. As for the 420 millimeter version, it averaged 53. So what does this all mean, and how does the Arctic Cooling Liquid Freezer 3s stack up in relative value versus AIOs? There's a lot to talk about here, but it's only fair that we give the Liquid Freezer 3 the Robitech value proposition treatment before we say anything else. But in order to do this, we're gonna have to math things out a bit differently today. Typically, we would do CPU thermal max, which is 100 degrees Celsius on modern Intel CPUs, subtract the CPU temperature under load, and then divide that number by the retail price. This would give us a dollars per degree of cooling value, which we could then score and compare. Since Ryzen CPUs operate a little bit differently here on a thermal curve, we're gonna do a similar equation, but we're gonna adjust the thermal max down to 95, which is the thermal junction max, or TJ max, for a Ryzen 7000 series CPU. We could then add those two numbers and average them, but we'll leave it at showing the value proposition for each platform and letting you be the judge. Now, in both scenarios, the Liquid Freezer 3 Black ends up being the value leader among AIOs that we've tested, with a relative value score of 4.64 on the Intel side and 14.44 on the AMD side. This one seems pretty hard to beat on this metric. Now, the ARGB version was ever so slightly behind its dark and brooding counterpart with a relative value of 5.55 on the Intel side and 16.66 on the AMD side. However, both AIOs had the Deepcool Mystique 360 hot on their heels with a relative value of 5.8 on Intel and 17.99 on AMD, and that one actually includes a complete LCD system, which is kind of crazy. Now, these numbers tell one story about value, but what if the value can be different depending on your point of view? And this is where we have to take everything we just talked about and draw our own conclusions. There's really, honestly, no way to do this, so we're just gonna rip the Band-Aid off. As AIOs go, we thought the Liquid Freezer 3 were just kind of okay. And we had some serious concerns over the popularity. While both the 360 millimeter and the 420 millimeter version we saw put on a good show during benchmarks, and they are budget friendly, we kept coming back to some nagging concerns that we couldn't quite move beyond. The first concern is that beyond the hype around these AIOs, that newer builders, should they hear about the hype and they see the price, would make a purchase based solely on those two factors. If this is you, we cannot express this strongly enough. Proceed with caution. Even if you are a seasoned veteran, know what you're getting into. We're no stranger to contact frames, but the margin of error goes up when you start taking apart your motherboard. Any missteps here could be catastrophic to your motherboard, your CPU socket, or the CPU itself. And we don't want that for basically anybody who's doing installation. So with that in mind, we have to count complexity of installation as a cost. Now, if you're saying, that's okay, Roby, I'm building an AMD system, I'm gonna say slow your roll. You're gonna wanna hear this part too, because our second concern is actually on the AMD side. We have to talk about the offset of the installation. Listen, we get what Arctic Cooling was saying here, and in a certain light, it seems like a bold but calculated move to optimize the cooling for AMD. However, we looked at the actual cooling performance on a Ryzen CPU. We're not sure it actually was a whole lot better versus the competition. Whether there is contact with the cold plate or not, heat is gonna find its way across the entire IHS. I mean, the S in IHS, it literally stands for spreader. Now, with the size of the cold plate on Liquid Freezer 3, we wonder if Liquid Freezer would perform better on AMD CPUs if the contact was across the board. Another thing, even though the IHS thing may not even be that big of a deal, the other thing too that's worth mentioning is just the bracket installation for AMD, which you have to put on a lot of pressure to be able to put that CPU down. In a lot of ways, there's a lot of bending to make sure that you get really good contact. In all of our cases, we ended up seeing issues where we weren't getting good contact, and we actually ended up having to do retesting because we felt like our data wasn't doing all that well. It's just not an easy beginner or even friendly installation process all up. And I know that we've seen this also mentioned by other reviewers who took a look at this, but as somebody who builds PCs all the time, when we think about value for AIOs, we have to look at the entire picture, including how you install and use the I/O. This is one place where we really feel like the Arctic Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs fall down. So where does this leave us? Overall, Arctic Cooling Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs offer good cooling performance on both AMD and Intel platforms at a cost-conscious price. And you know what? Honestly, they do good for cooling. When we consider all the extra steps and the odd to us design decisions, we had a hard time wrapping our heads around the hype. Listen, we're not trying to yuck your yum here. Essentially, if you're a diehard fan of Arctic Cooling Liquid Freezer 3 AIOs, these AIOs do the job they have been designed to do. They basically, Arctic Cooling took an out of the box approach to design the Liquid Freezer 3. For that, we have to give them props. So here's where we land. If you're an experienced builder looking to maximize cooling and minimize expense, the Liquid Freezer 3 is worth considering. However, if you're unsure about what you're doing when it comes to installing AIOs, these are not as forgiving for beginners. We'd recommend either like getting help or checking your temps or working with more seasoned builders just to verify that your installation went correctly. And to be honest, when we really honestly think about the cost, there are AIOs like the DeepCools that are cheaper, easier, simpler, and just as performant as these that may be better options all up if you just don't want to mess with things. So these are where our thoughts on the Arctic Freezer Liquid 3 360mm and 420mm IOs. But I want to know what you think down in the comments. Do you agree with our opinion? Honestly, like, what do you think about stuff where it's price and at the same time it may sacrifice things like installation? I'd love to know all that and more down in the comments below. Now, while you're down there, go ahead and slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post videos like this right here on Robitech. Also, if you want to continue the conversation, you know what? Because we have techs and other PC enthusiasts who'd love to share their thoughts and talk to you, and maybe some of them really do love this AIO, head on over to our Discord server, discord.gg/Robitech, an amazing place to meet other tech and PC enthusiasts that would love to have these conversations. And who knows, you might make a friend. Also, feel free to follow me at Robitech absolutely everywhere. Thank you so much for watching this video, and we look forward to seeing you on the next one.